Verlede week se SMS-vraag was of julle dink die willekeurs gemyn moet word of nie. 588 het nee gesê en net 6 mense ja. Ek dink dit spreek vanself. Saam met my in die ateljee is Jacinto Rocha. He is the Deputy Director General for Mineral Regulation at the Department of Minerals and Energy, and also John Clark, social worker and representing the NGO Sustaining the Wild Coast. Gentlemen, thank you for joining me. Welcome to the program.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Jacinto, let me start with you. From our SMS question, it seems more than 99% of our viewers who took part in this are opposed to the mining. The majority of people that we've interviewed over the years doing various programs on this issue also seemed opposed to it. It's also the idea I get looking in the general media. When you look at all of this, how is it possible? How did it happen that you gave the mining right?
I think if I understand my Afrikaans correctly, your question related to mining the Wild Coast, I think it's a very misleading question.
Why?
Because the Wild Coast is at least 5,000 kilometers long. The area where they've applied consisted of 4 blocks. We have allowed them, we have granted them a right for 1 block. Now, how do we assess applications? Because I think you're trying to bring together comment of people who are opposed generally in the process of licensing. When we license applications, we look at the company's technical ability, financial ability, compliance with environmental requirements. We also look with the compliance with social and labor plan. And the fifth element is compliance with mine health and safety. In the process, people are invited to comment on the applications. Now, to respond that 588 people have, through an SMS, have said no, I don't know whether these people participated in the consultation process. So it becomes, yes, it is good for the media. It does not help us to take a decision.
Okay, but let me stop you there. And first of all, I don't think it's misleading because it does refer to one of the most pristine parts of the Wild Coast. At the same time, you may be a little bit misleading here in the sense that, yes, you've given rights for one block, but at the same time, the company has the right to keep on prospecting with the idea that the other blocks along this coast may be added to this in time.
I think it's important that to emphasize that you said maybe. Mm. So one cannot be misleading with a maybe.
Can I, in a sense, I'm actually with Jacinto in one respect, that I think it's a bit of an oversimplification because, you know, issues like mineral rights and that aren't decided by a democratic vote. The mineral rights are obviously something since the mining charter meant for the country as a whole. But what is the more important question in it, which I'd like to ask Jacinto is, and then maybe just to reflect a bit of my own experience of 2 years working with the local community. In September last year, the King and Queen of the Amapondo came to a special mbizo in the community where, and I was astonished. I mean, I went in there thinking that there would be people bussed in from all sorts of other places to dilute the local opposition. And my interest, and I have to say, are the people directly affected who live on that 22-kilometre coastal strip.
Those whose land it is.
Yes. And at that meeting, to my astonishment, there were some 2,000 people present. They didn't take an SMS poll, but just from the interaction between the King and Queen and this people, they were overwhelmingly opposed to it, misinformed about it, and pleading for them, their voices to be heard. Now, I'd made a point of inviting the Department of Energy, Department of Land Affairs, and the mining company to come and hear for themselves. Because if you ask me, am I for or against mining the Wild Coast, that's also the wrong question to ask me. It's a question of their fundamental human rights, which in this particular instance have been grossly violated. And the Human Rights Commission were there, and they saw it. And I'm not talking for myself. Read their report, and they say that. there was an overwhelmingly people were opposed to it and hadn't been informed. The next episode was when the Human Rights Commission had to issue a ministerial subpoena to the Departments of Environmental Affairs, yourselves, and Land Affairs, to submit documentation to show that you were in compliance with the legislation. Now, I hadn't asked them to do that. All I had done on behalf of my clients was to put before the Human Rights Commission a four-page complaint about violations that we alleged of human rights in the Constitution. The Human Rights Commission chose to go a step further to knowing how incendiary the issue was in the Pondoland historical context to try and make sure that our institutional structures and systems were there to support the people. My clients have asked me, Mr. Rocha, to ask you to please come and spend time with them the way I've had to do for the last 2 years and hear what they are trying to say.
I think you are a social worker for that community.
Yes.
And you have been representing them in different...
No, I don't represent them. I'm not a lawyer. Lawyers represent. I help communities articulate their own interests.
Let me use a different word. You have been speaking on their behalf.
No, I haven't. I've been facilitating their voices to be heard.
Let's hear what you're saying.
Let me then use what you are saying, because whatever you are saying, otherwise you would not be sitting here. The whole community would be sitting here today if you are not...
Well, they would be if they could afford
you. If you are not speaking on their behalf, if you are not facilitating. So whatever
take the debate forward.
You didn't ask me a question. So as far as we are aware and we are concerned, consultation has taken place. And I've read a number of documents. The debate is whether consultation was sufficient or not. Okay. And you have also indicated that you agreed with me that in a licensing process, it is not a democratic decision.
Who makes the decision?
In terms of the act, okay?
Yes.
Without delegation, it is the minister.
Minister of Minerals and Energy.
Minister of Minerals and Energy. Now, if minister is delegated, which in this case it has been delegated to Director General, then the Director General takes the decision. In the process, as I indicated, consultation does take place. In every consultation, there is always a debate whether it was sufficient or not. And interestingly enough, those who are opposed say they never consulted. Those who are in favor, they always say that they were consulted. And this is the debate that one engages in. So it is true that the community, there are two groups. One who is in support, the other is not in support.
If I can.
And for your information, the minister is going to, it's not the first time that the minister goes there, but the minister is going to that area on Friday, and there is a meeting.
Now, we are aware of that, and my clients asked if the Minister of Environmental Affairs would also attend, and the Minister of Land Affairs, so that they can get some clarity from the confusion that exists from our government administration.
This is my next question is, under the new EIA system that we have in the country, who has the final say from an environmental point of view? Is DME the watchdog for the environment as well in a case like this, or is DEET, the Department of Environmental Affairs, do they still have a say? And if there is an opposing say between the two departments, who makes the final call?
Okay. I think it's important to clarify. The MPRDA has not been amended yet. Mineral and Petroleum Resource Development Act has not been amended yet. So we regulate in terms of what is provided for in the law now. In terms of the licensing process, including environment, the Minister of Minerals and Energy has the final say. It may change in future, but currently, and I don't know what your reference to a new system, I don't know when this new system will come into effect sometime in future. But currently, the Minister of Minerals and Energy has the final say. Now, does the Minister of Minerals and Energy then consult with other departments? The answer is yes.
But now, this is a good example of the danger of that, where the people who have to make the decision, who stand to gain from a decision like this, are also the people who have to be the watchdog in a process like this.
I think I would want to debate with you on that. Number one, danger is your opinion. Number two, who stands to gain? Is it the minister? Because the minister does not take a decision in a private capacity. The minister takes a decision in an official capacity. So what is the minister standing to gain?
Well, in a matter of finances versus environment, for example, it's a financial decision. Yeah. The gain will be on the financial side. The loss will be on an environmental side. I mean, we're talking here of a stretch that lies between two estuaries. How will you ever be able to rehabilitate them? We're talking an area that has 200 endemic species. How are we going to put that back? DME has a horrible history when it comes to rehabilitation. Let's look at the Brits Kopis or any of the other areas that we've covered in the past.
You are interviewing us as a journalist. Mm. I thought that journalists are impartial, they're objective. When you make accusations...
We are also informed and we're also...
When you make accusations as a journalist, bring facts.
I can.
So we're not attacking journalism. So let's deal with facts. As a journalist, be objective. Let the debate be between myself and my friend, Mr. Clark, here, not with you. As a journalist,
I've tried to get interviews with you on numerous occasions. I've only succeeded on very few. We cover these stories, we are informed about it, but we do not get the answers from DME.
I thought that this was an interview on Xolobeni, not on whether you were successful.
Can I interject,
asking me for interviews?
I'm beginning to feel like a social worker mediating in a marriage conflict here, and I want you to fall into another role. But I have to say also, as a social worker, I've tried to keep perspective and not to allow my own feelings get involved. But I have to say, as I've become involved and built relations with the community, it has been extremely hard for me to stay within my professional role as well, because it is outrageous. But let me ask you, Mr. Stone, why is MRC not speaking out and explaining themselves and leaving it to you and to supposition and to guesswork? Because the perception is that the Department of Mineral Energy is more scared of what MRC is going to do to you than giving accountability to the community. And I can tell you why they don't want to come and speak to you. Because on Monday I was interviewing an Induna who was telling me how Patrick Caruso took a whole group of people to Richards Bay Minerals to persuade them. And in the process of driving up there, he plied him with liquor to the point that when he got to Richards Bay, he was completely dagiwe and not compass meant not able to properly represent the story when he got back. Now, that was volunteered to me. I did not solicit it. And if a mining company claiming to be a catalyst for social development is behaving like that, and promoting social ills and alcohol abuse, and that's just the beginning. You saw the program on Monday of Scorpion Damani and how he sought to speak out against what he perceived to be bribery and corruption. He wasn't, unfortunately, able to be cross-questioned now. I'm not wanting to get into speculation as to all that, but the fact of the matter is we now have many other community members who are at last now coming forward. Do you see where it puts the poor minister in a position? She's now going to face that community on Friday and having to justify the fact that she is dealing with a bunch of crooks and manipulators. And I'm prepared to stand by that under professional scrutiny.
I think, I'm here speaking for DME. So as to why the company doesn't want to come, I don't know.
I've just given you a good reason.
Yeah, there was a request for DME to come and
they're cowards.
Now, in terms of we being scared, DME, the decision that we have taken, it's not about the company. So what it is, MRC, TM, or whichever company, we are not in love with a company. What DME's position is looking at that community and asking ourselves, at this stage, what are the available instruments that we have that is going to assist us in facilitating the eradication of poverty? Number two, DME has a position where, in a country where we live, where 50% of our people are poor, we are going to try and make use of all the available resources to assist us in addressing the challenges that we face. We do not have a position or a view that mining and any other form of tourism is mutually exclusive. So we have not taken that position. We have not taken a position that says, because we have granted the mining rights to a company, therefore, the added economic activity should not take place.
So you think the tourists will still come even if you mine the dunes?
And
is that what you're saying?
If they had done more to help the tourism.
Yeah, if they
but
were
they
not...
But they haven't. They've absolutely sabotaged
if they were not coming, if they were not coming, possibly for any other reason, they will not come in future. If the challenge is, and I think this is where, when we engage in a debate over issues, it's important that we become constructive. Both of us are interested in addressing poverty. The question for us, which tools are we going to use to address that? Well, if the challenge is, for example, that how can we then use MRC to facilitate the attraction of tourists to that area? The question is, DME, you have this instrument called the Social and Labor Plan. Mm. How do we then use that to still attract tourists to that area? But what has been happening is, we have engaged in, we have not been consulted, I'm against that, and we were not dealing with the real issue. The real issue in that area is not about the mining right that has been issued or ecotourism that may take place. The real issue there is poverty. How do we then address it? Because if an environmentalist, you know, that you can protect trees, you can protect animals. If people are poor, they are poor. Okay. Those animals, those birds will not be protected. So the challenge that we have is to say, let's look back and say, if this is the debate that we are confronted with, and the main issue that we have is poverty, how do we address it? What instruments do we use?
On that sense,
I would love to be able to, and I have tried. When I spoke to Nomvuyo Khetse, your district manager, we had a good relationship going. Mm. And I said, look, please understand, this is a highly explosive issue. How can I facilitate to generate light rather than heat? I've been a social worker for 30 years. My previous assignment was with the World Health Organization, where I went to Somalia and Zimbabwe and places like that. I know what I'm talking about when it comes to poverty and humanitarian response. You don't solve the problem by having the likes of MRC and Mr. Caruso. Another instance, one of the men in the crisis committee who have actually taken up under great duress, I learned that Mr. Caruso is actually trying to lure their wives into a BEE partnership with him, saying to them, why do you support John Clark? Your husband support John Clark. He's got no money. Come support us. Mm. So what is he doing? He's driving a wedge within the families. Mm. Now, what does that... I mean, poverty is not just a material condition. And when you come to that community, they might be materially poor, but there's a sense of community solidarity with each other, which overwhelms me. And so as many people get concerned about the biodiversity and endemism, my passion right now is for the people there who have shown such generosity of spirit in welcoming people, and then to have the likes of Mr. Caruso coming in and actually wreaking havoc. It can't be allowed to happen.
What we'll have to do, and if you have seen DME, we're not focusing on the company. The main issue for us was how to address poverty. And I've also indicated to you, we are not in love with the company. It's not about them. It's about DME wanting to find a tool that is going to assist us in addressing poverty. If they are bad boys, we have a way in dealing with them. So this is not an issue.
I can understand. I have a quick question then. Does that mean that when they get their mining rights, they will sell it on to somebody else? That's the other concern that we have.
So fortunately, if they want to sell, they still have to come back to us.
So can I just suggest you put some very strict constraints on that? Reparations for the damage they've done to the tourism industry is the first obligation that they have. Put that as a condition for them.
It's fine to say that it's about poverty, but it's also about long-term versus short-term. The life of a mine like that, as I understand, would be 22 years. Whereas the potential from a purely tourism on an unspoiled stretch of land on which we're running out of on this planet probably has a much longer term potential for income. and for solving problems like poverty. So have you made those calculations? Have you taken them into account in your decision?
I think we have to be very careful when we make long-term projections. Number one, there were attempts in ecotourism, Amadiba Adventures. I don't know where it is going.
I can give you a very good answer.
So the argument that they are long-term sustaining ecotourism or whatever, the instrument that we are going to use is business.
So are you saying that we can go and mine through the national park and it will be fine?
Just a moment. Let's go back to Xolobeni and I'll respond to that. We are using business. We are using company. To argue that a company is sustainable is very misleading. Okay? Let's not confuse a resource with a company.
Yeah, I wasn't talking company. I was talking the potential of an industry.
Ecotourism is not a resource. You promote tourism through using a company. And this is, because companies are liquidated. So the debate of sustainability.
I don't understand. Mining also goes through a company, so I don't understand your point.
Your argument was mining is short term, the others are long term. So, and I'm trying to tell you, I think we have to be very careful.
I'm saying in 22 years, there'll be nothing left to mine. In 100 years, there'll still be a waterfall.
Yeah, but there were a lot of waterfalls in the Witwatersrand area, and they are not there anymore.
So we're not proud of that, so let's not go there.
I think, let's see, I'm trying to say, please, when you're presenting arguments, see, one of the challenges of being a human being, we always have this tendency of thinking that what we think is the correct approach. Now, on Kruger National Park, I think you are aware that there are different classes or categories of parks. Now, in terms of existing law, you cannot mine in the Kruger National Park.
I realize that.
So you are not going to mine there. So it's a very bad example to give. But I think what I'm trying to show you...
So you're saying that if there wasn't a law, you could mine there? The point I'm making is you're not looking at the environmental side of this balance sheet.
But there is a law that you can't mine the wild coast. It's the Transguard Decree 9.
It's a very hypothetical. See, you're trying to ask me...
Okay, let's make it practical. How final is this decision of yours to issue this right? Can it still be reversed? Let's say there's a huge public outcry. Let's say I bring you 20 million signatures tomorrow. What is there any possibility of still reversing this decision, or is it final?
My friend John Clark has indicated to you that you, in the decision making, it's not democracy. So there is one person that takes the decision.
In terms of the law, then.
For instance, if somebody is aggrieved, so we have the courts. Number one, because the minister is not the one who took the decision, they can appeal the decision. Okay? Mm. If they then are not satisfied with the minister's decision, then they can go to court, where this is challenged in court. So in as far as the decision is concerned, it is closed. So you'll not have the director general, because of the 20 million signature, goes back and say, I think I have to review. He cannot do it in terms of law. Mm. But people can appeal to the minister, and there are organizations that intend doing so. And then if you fail with the minister, then there is a court. If you fail in the high court, you go to the appeal court until you get to the constitutional court. But the issue is not about we're not happy, because when you say you're not happy, you are not happy on what basis? Why is it that because when we are arguing about human rights, the right to socioeconomic development is also a human right. So in the process of me saying, let's address the Amadiba Crisis Committee's concern, how do we then address the concern of those who are in favor? Because they also have human rights. So this is, and I think this is, we have to have a sensible debate, and which is what we are not having.
And we need a level playing field, which there has not been. Because the same people that run Amadiba Adventurers are the same people employed by MRC for the mining. I have personal experience of taking people down to Mtintu and seeing the women who were there to serve us not having been provided with food or anything despite the fact we had paid in advance, and these women having to go and scrounge around from the village to actually feed us, and they still did it.
See, this is
so you can see why I feel so passionate.
See, the debate here is we have misplaced the debate. The debate is around
justice. That's what it is.
All of us, those of us who live in Johannesburg now, and from time to time we want to get out of this life, we think about watching the birds with our binoculars. For people, there is life and death. And I think as a social worker also there, it's, as you said, in the beginning you asked yourselves, if you were to ask me, am I pro or against mining? And you didn't answer it because your concern is development.
It is.
And your concern is following justice. Now, for there are some of us who we have this luxurious lives, we have our cars, and we think that the challenge there is just about protecting the environment, and we use the term pristine. Poverty is sensitive too.
Absolutely.
And what we are being requested to do is now to juxtapose, to compare between protection of birds against real life challenges that people have. And I don't think that we should really be placed in the position where we have to choose. The challenge there, in that area, those of us who have been there, and I've been there, you cannot, as a South African, accept that we engage in these luxurious debates and the people's lives are the ones at stake.
Yeah, well, that's exactly why I've been trying to engage, dear me.
Anyway, honestly, gentlemen, thank you very much. We've run out of time.
Anyway,
I'm sure we haven't run out of time on the complete debate yet. We'll be watching it. We'll be coming back to you. We'll be saying what is happening as it happens. Some people would be opposing it. Let's hope not too much taxpayers' money goes into defending the court case. We'll see what time brings. But, gentlemen, thank you very much for the debate. I appreciate your presence here. And remember that it's time for our SMS question. Keep your pens and papers at hand. Later on in the program, I'll give you the exact question and we'll make sure that your voice is also heard, even if it doesn't help. Until 31st of October, then we'll let you know what the final outcome is.